It's really a pleasure to be here. I always considered an honor to be asked. And obviously this topic was timely when I was invited many months ago and more timely today. So I chose serving two masters because I'll probably be emphasizing the pitch that one test can't do all the things we want it to do. And that I realize that we are operating in an environment of way, way, way too much testing. Little startling that Boulder, you know, where I read the paper every morning, is one of the complainers because they actually have fewer tests than most of the testing that is done in this country. So we're going to talk about what's happened to most school districts across the nation, and then also be sympathetic to recent stories from Boulder or Jeffco. But I also pasted up here the Washington Post because I want to emphasize that this is a national phenomenon. One teaser before we jump in. I am very worried as a testing expert that the anti-testing feelings in an environment, which I will try to explain, could make us give up the best tests and keep the worst. So that's a uh-oh that was on my mind as I was trying to prepare this talk. So this is how I was feeling emotionally when I was trying to say how I'm going to talk to you today. So, and I would be ageist if I weren't talking about myself when I say I just felt very, very old and weary. Like how could I get myself up to thinking in an affirmative way about what we could do about these issues? So I'm 68 years old. I, in 1972, got my PhD, and the first job I had was to help the state of California develop a non-accountability test to examine for its internal uses how schools were doing. And it was fashioned after the still new then National Assessment of Educational Progress. And it was meant to gather data broadly using a sampling strategy to help us learn how to make schools better. And I was still in those kinds of jobs when we started to understand what accountability movements would do to shame schools and what effects it came over a long period of time to have effects on schooling and how we taught, et cetera. Very sort of dismal sense that I had in trying to put together this talk. And, you know, Yogi Berra is just about, and the same mistakes and misunderstandings, good intentions gone bad, how many ways can I say it, seem to be with us all of the time. So here's how I've organized the talk. I want to tell you the problem. And I want you to understand in my presentation how old it is. This problem caused by standardized testing has been with us easily since those accountability efforts in the 1970s and 80s when the stakes started being raised. The solution we have known for a long time and tried to institute it pretty systematically on a large scale in many states in the early 1990s. I want you to understand why it didn't work, what has happened since to make it worse, and how, if I could keep up my optimism, we could possibly try to re-examine and recraft and emphasize what we know about a solution. Okay, so here's my one slide. 30 years, and when I was trying to put this slide together, I went through easily 40 talks I've given. There are a couple of like old slides in here, maybe you'll see them, and it's one reason that I had to use an old format for everything so the old slides wouldn't be too obvious. And this is a new slide though, because I committed, instead of giving you the whole talk about this, to tell you everything there is to know about the research on the negative effects of standardized testing in one slide. That is not to say that in some of those more thoughtful papers, there weren't here some good things and some bad things about standardized testing, but if the theme that you must understand is that it's way out of whack, then you understand that this set of harms is what's landing and has been landing for a long time. Curriculum distortion being probably the most serious. And curriculum distortion you know all about. In each of your districts, you know how much of art, music, PE, social studies, and science have been abandoned because of standardized testing. And that's not even the real problem. So here's what, as an expert with lots of data, I could do to add to your understanding of curriculum distortion. It has harmed even the way we teach math and reading. And we did studies in the 1980s where we showed what would happen if we gave two assessments, multiple choice, open-ended, in a district where neither was familiar. And then we took those same assessments and went to a district where there had been teaching to the multiple choice test. And the drop-off in performance in assessment on the open-ended test for the kids that have been taught to the other was a third to a half standard deviation. Enormous. So what's happening is that when kids and teachers practice to a test that asks third graders to circle one of three umbrellas. This is a real example. I've used this before. And then on the test, it's circle one of three ice cream cones. The kids can do it. But then if you ask those same kids, circle a third of nine marbles, and they can't do it. So, I don't know, that example resonates with me. Because when you teach what one third is and what one half is and what one quarter is, you want kids to be able to understand it, whether it's of a pizza or a certain number of ice cream cones or a set of marbles. And if you practice to one kind of test, you can't do it. Test score inflation follows from what I just said. The scores go up, the learning doesn't. It also creates perverse incentives. Later on, I'll show you a slide about teachers teaching to the bubble kids. I'm sure you've heard about that. And equally serious, but not as well studied, but researchers do look at this, is what kids come to think learning is for. And to the extent that the lowest performing kids are taught that learning is to get good at tests and performing on tests, they have a very limited understanding of what the reason is for learning. And if they fail, it's even worse, right? Because then they've learned on the only thing that matters, I'm not any good. So now we're going to talk about the general history. I'm going to focus on the testing, but it's important to remember that we've done this standards-based reform before. And in the 1990s, this is one of a million reports that lays out what we were trying to do then. Get rid of de facto low-level basic skills curriculum driven by tests and textbooks. Establish challenging standards aimed at higher-order thinking. Replace it with critical thinking, and you have pretty much what we're trying to do again. Link standards to the high quality assessments and invest in capacity building, because a lot of people knew that if you just did the hard tests without the capacity building, it might not work. Focusing today on the parts of that reform movement in the early 90s that are still now what we need to think about regarding assessment, the two main messages were tests worth teaching to. That's one way to get around that training to the ice cream cone example, is have such a broad assessment system, that if you tried to get good at what was on the assessments, you would be doing good instruction, tests worth teaching to. And an important part of the reforms and research in the 90s was to understand the importance of the difference between large-scale assessments and classroom assessments, but that they need to be coherent substantively, so that what I'm doing in the classroom is toward the same aims as the large-scale test, but it's a different test. So here are a couple of examples. This is something California developed back in those 90s days, before their ambitious test was driven out of being. But here's an example for fifth graders where they have to have cardboard and a bunch of sand, and they shift the cardboard to simulate the San Andreas Fault. And then they have to answer a bunch of questions about, you know, like, what would that mountain range look like if? And it's an example of the kind of task that would be good instruction, good assessment that could happen in the context of instruction. But if you've been doing lots of those kinds of things with your students, you could also use one of these kinds of assessment devices on your large-scale test. Not the same ones, of course. And here's an example from the state of Maryland, where kids were asked to fill out the chart. This is third graders being asked, how many scoops would you need to make lemonade? If they come to understand the proportion between one scoop for every cup, for every two cups that I'm trying to make. So these are things where they have to explain their reasoning, they have to extrapolate the table, they have to show they understand the proportion. And these are what we mean by deeper substantive tasks that are needed so that we don't have tests that are distorting the curriculum, right? This is the solution, the answer to that hugely pervasive problem from teaching to low-level tests. We also, in those days, in the 90s, came to understand why the two kinds of tests, accountability and classroom, needed to be separate. So here's a report that we wrote in early childhood explaining standardized assessment data must be collected in a standardized way so that the comparisons are valid. Pretty sensible, reasonable thing. To support learning and development, the content of classroom tests and assessments must be closely aligned with what the children are learning right when they're learning it. It does not do you any good to get great data 6 weeks from, even 3 weeks from, when the kids are in the act of learning. The assessment research about supporting student learning is real-time interaction. And it means you need very little information, right? The best intervention is about one thing that would help the kids learn better right then, not a battery of information delayed and remote. And this same idea was in this very famous report that I'm going to rely on a couple of times in the talk, Knowing What Students Know. This was published in 2001. By a panel of the National Academy of Sciences, which means it took them years to write this report. But it had all the most famous experts in content areas, in psychometrics, in policy research, and coming together to say some important things about, at that time, 2001, next generation assessments. And one of the most important insights from the report was this idea of separation. There are chairs up here, you all, if you're interested. Come on down. It's all right. It won't be disruptive. This important idea of separating the large-scale assessment from the classroom assessment, but attending to how they should be related to each other. Similarly, and expanding on that idea, here are all the ways that the large-scale and the classroom tests are different. Standardized versus dynamic. uniform versus variable dates. It would be unfair if there wasn't a testing window for the statewide comparisons, not so for working with individual kids, right? Getting the timing right may mean I'll assess these kids this week and different groups more in depth a different week. Independent performance versus assisted performance. Asking a question that gives a hint is a fabulous instructional device when I'm using assessment to support kids' learning. An inappropriate, dishonest device if I'm administering a standardized test for fair comparisons. All of these things, delayed in timing, no problem actually, and I know we might disagree about this, but getting this stuff aggregated in time to plan for the next year should be sufficient for the large scale test and is a different purpose. Now, we don't want to do onerous testing to do that, but we want to have immediate knowledge, immediate insight to work with individual kids. Very different purposes for the feedback. And again, I'm emphasizing the word coherence, which that Knowing What Students Know panel said was so important as the link between what's going on at the state level and what's going on day to day in the classroom. So why do the reforms not work? Direct attacks. People didn't like the politics of it in the first place. Competing visions, and I'm going to elaborate on that with one pretty striking example. Subversion by superficial understandings. And I do think that this phrase that we chose for today's talk about instructional relevance, every time you try to make the accountability test instructionally relevant, and I will try to say by the end how I think that can be done, but if you think it can be there, the week you want to improve this student's understanding, you're going to ruin the accountability test and not help this student either. So that's, I have to keep coming back to these competing visions. And the reason most profoundly that the testing has gone wrong in these reforms that didn't work is that content experts wanted better tests, but policymakers wanted more tests. And that happened through the 90s, and it happened profoundly in the 2000s. So here's a nice reference for you to understand further why the reforms didn't work. This is a different National Academy of Sciences. National Research Council is the research arm of the National Academy of Sciences. And this is an important report that they put out. And they showed how by the end of the 90s, it was a mess. And it was a mess because as early, right, I told you the reforms didn't start till the 90s. And as early as 1994, we had two competing visions, both generating effort and policy. So Clinton's Goals 2000, had this idea, a vision of coherent capacity building. Yes, we're going to set these Field of Dreams standards, but we're going to help people get there. We're going to have an understanding of how different it is. The profound thing about those standards was research on how you could help kids get to standards that had never been accomplished previously, how what had been reserved for elite and gifted students previously could be delivered to everyone. I mean, it was a really big proposal, right? And how out of reach it was understood by some of the proposers. And that's why they kept using the phrase capacity building. But right alongside them were the incentivizers. And the incentivizers passed different rules. And the incentivizers, same year, the ESEA had a vision of punishments, exposing who wasn't making it and punishing. Very interesting, since we set standards at the 75th percentile. Right, Colorado did it. Our first CSAP standards in reading were set at the 70th percentile. You could look it up, where it was set. And then in the public mind, though, everybody used grade level to go with proficiency. But that used to be the 50th percentile. So the discourse was horribly muddled, continues to be horribly muddled around, should we just set really hard standards and that'll be setting high expectations? Or do we have to have capacity building to realize we've never done this before? What does it take to help people do it? And this is just a useful reference if you want to see what happens from that kind of overreach and not help. This is a very good book in 2003 by Dick Elmore and colleagues at Harvard. The idea is to understand with accountability pressure who gets better and who can't. And what he finds is, these are from extensive case studies in all of these schools, that the well-resourced schools that also have an ethos of internal accountability are able to organize themselves under high-stakes pressure to get better. Pick which things, figure out what they don't know, go get resources, get better. The under-resourced schools scramble. It's almost like, you know, the rats in a maze. If it's just a hot tin roof kind of environment, but no resource, and you don't know how to solve the problem, you didn't already know how to solve the problem, or you would have been solving it, things just get more and more chaotic instead of the accountability pressure actually improving. So this is late 90s. He's describing in his 2003 book. And then what happened? NCLB. And I have famously used Darth Vader as my best image about the standardized testing that I used early on and that now in spades was exacerbated by No Child Left Behind, because what was out of reach before is now out of reach with a vengeance under No Child Left Behind. So, remember my outline? We're now all the way to point four now, how it got worse. It didn't work for all the reasons I've just enumerated, and with NCLB it got worse, because nationally, now this isn't true in every district in Colorado. It is true in many districts in Colorado. Because of NCLB, good tests were replaced with more numerous bad tests. That happened at the state level. More grade levels had to be tested. And what I'm calling here the fledgling new formative assessment efforts were replaced by commercial interim tests that look just like the bad state tests. So the three ice cream cones, circle one-third, are this pretty much what multiple choice items look like that are being administered in the lion's share, and we've done actual formal surveys of who has the command of the market, who's selling the most interim tests, and what do they look like. And some of them are proudly items from the 1970s, so they aren't magically next generation assessments, and yet these have been installed in district after district. Why? To help people get better on the state tests. So naturally, they imitate the state tests very closely. So to give you an idea about this, what was given up, I planned one slide. Okay, another whole talk, one slide, about formative assessment and why it was so important, could still be so important. And this is research actually generated mostly outside the US. So the same story that I told about our research in the 1980s finding the negative effects of teaching two multiple choice tests and the efforts to change it by changing the character of the assessments, interestingly, is going on in other countries. And the formative assessment movement actually was the most informed by the assessment reform group in Great Britain and by Australia and New Zealand, and to a certain extent by the continental researchers in mathematics education in particular. So they brought a totally different understanding to the research than those in this country that were working on better representations, better content representations of the assessment tasks. And they looked more at the assessment processes. The reform group actually commissioned the paper that Black and William wrote in 1998 that brought together a compendium of all the research on classroom assessment that had been to that time. And the important thing about those studies was that they weren't just starting then. They were bringing together all of the work that had been done for the preceding decades in cognitive research, showing what kinds of formative assessment processes in classrooms would, for example, support students' meta-analytic skills. Reflecting on my own learning is sort of what we're thinking about with meta-analysis. And similarly, all the motivation research that showed what kinds of feedback enhance learning and what kinds of feedback actually decrease learning. And it has to do with whether it's focused on the product and performance or on my own sense of increasing competence. So when you hear people worried about teaching kids a performance orientation or teaching them an extrinsic motivational stance, you're invoking the motivational research about how it is that intrinsic motivation is supported, and even research that shows us that relying on extrinsic motivation can actually drive out intrinsic motivation. And I know I've told this before, but maybe not to anyone in this audience. There's huge meta-analysis on this intrinsic versus extrinsic motivation. The best study story from that whole body of research is one about kindergarten students who the researchers go in and they record what the kids all like doing best, painting or building with blocks or dress up or whatever it is, and then they start giving them rewards, extrinsic rewards, for doing things. And then after the study is over, they find that the kids that rewarded to do painting stopped liking painting even if they had preferred painting before the study. So that's profound to me because it helps you understand what the researchers mean when they summarize extrinsic rewards can drive out intrinsic rewards. And the important thing about the formative assessment literature is that it is respectful of what kinds of processes in the classroom, how I engage students so that they value the feedback, so that they feel safe in exposing what they don't understand, and that's how they learn from the feedback, as opposed to, no, it's a performance because your worth as a person is going to be judged by how well you score on that test. And very distressing to me how much that's how kids are being talked to about the interim assessments. So here's more of the story. Since NCLB swept in and people bought interim assessments to try to get ready for the end of year tests, here's how it got worse. And I'm not a big fan of database decision making, but I don't want to diss it since I'm sure at least half the room's really into it. And I want to acknowledge that when there's a culture of continuous improvement, like I'm a dean, right? I was introduced as a dean, and I hope that that's how we use data regularly. We actually have data retreats in my school of education. So I believe in using data. I try to be thoughtful about it, like not inundate people with too much and let everybody in the community help decide from the data what one or two things we think we want to work on, because I want it to make sense to everyone. So I'm not absolutely against database decision making, but I do think it has been part of the ethos that is contributing to the problem of over-testing. So we had a big fight in the 2005 or so. We even, in the literature, so that's why I'm quoting myself there, argued about whether commercial test providers of this every 6 week interim tests could call them formative assessments. Finally, sort of the interim or benchmark was settled on as a compromise, because the reason we were fighting about it is we said all that stuff from the previous slide about Black and Williams saying that here's what formative assessment can accomplish, it's not those things you're doing. Doesn't look like that, and so you have to stop calling it that. So eventually this new word, interim assessments, was arrived at. I agree that interim assessments can be used formatively, but you have to know sort of what all the argument is for doing it well in a way that is not just layering on negative information without conceptual insight that'll help me get better. So here I'm invoking Deming and trying to say, yes, I agree with the idea of a continuously improving environment and culture for my organization, but this can't work if there is a flood of data and if there's no way to draw links, which is one problem with not very good tests, if there's nothing to be done about it, or if people don't have the support to figure out what to do, the interim assessment information will not necessarily be helpful. So here's access to quite a number of studies have been done recently. Unlike the formative assessment literature that was summarizing, you know, 20 years of research on cognitive motivational effects from formative assessment, the interim assessment literature is very new. It is only a recent phenomenon, so of course there couldn't be very much. This is a couple of you are raising your hands, but you're just like waving, so it's okay. this special issue of the Peabody Journal was all about the studies that had been done to try to look at this new phenomenon of the interim assessments. And so I'm just quoting from several of them. What they find, though, is that this large understanding of not knowing what to do when we get the information, or focusing on bubble kids, or the district just emphasizing the scores, these are some of the things that we have to be alert to coming out of this research. And then here I'm citing the studies that I and my colleagues at CREST, UCLA's Center for Research on Students and Testing. What we did was study two districts in California and five districts in Colorado and interviewed teachers about how they were using the assessment data. Quoting from one teacher, poor performance signals a need to change our instruction in some way, but there isn't advice about how to improve. Reteaching the weakest standard was the most prevalent use. So what most teachers, when we asked them to come to this interview with samples, and we did staged interviews over a couple of weeks so that we could talk and then say, well, next time we meet, could you bring such and such? The most frequent thing that teachers showed us was that grid that you get from most benchmark or interim tests, which shows you your class list and all of the standards across the top. And what we found out was that most teachers pick the one standard that had the fewest satisfactories in it, and the kids that most needed something else. But there was no, what we called, no substantive insight. And we asked, so when you saw that they couldn't do this, did the test help you figure out what about that they didn't understand? No. And I think after doing all this research, what I came away with was a shorthand that says the thing that's wrong with these kinds of tests is that they're constructed to produce scores. Yeah, even reliable scores, because they'd be criticized if they didn't produce reliable scores. And it's not scores that the teachers need. What teachers need is something about the problem that the kids don't understand, and that would help them intervene substantively. So this is the kind of worry that I would invite you to have about these kinds of assessments if they're being used in your districts. Okay, so the closing set of slides. Take me a few more minutes. What can we do? Whoops, I went too fast. Recrafting the solution. Confused. This again is what I said before about the old solution. So I'm just reiterating that the solution, if we want to do it with the wisdom of past mistakes informing us, is to develop better tests that better embody the learning goals and understand this separation so that we can get the external tests to do what we want them to do with less burden, and can get better assessment, like that could really support student learning, to the students and the teachers when they most need it. And what would that look like? So it requires us to understand what we want from the large-scale assessments. Refocus on conceptually rich tasks that are the full embodiment of ambitious learning goals. So let's take a few minutes with this slide and ask ourselves, what would this look like? We just recently was one of the experts asked to produce a report on the future of NAEP, the future of the National Assessment of Educational Progress. That study is posted with the NES, National NCES, National Center for Education Statistics. And for the future of NAEP, we said, look, why don't you realize that everybody wants comparisons, and furthermore, they want comparisons to everything, right? So PISA is now coming and asking big districts, do you want PISA? It is perfectly easy to rotate into NAEP at random among students so that you have a perfect sample. Example tasks from PISA that can be equated back to PISA, example tasks from the old NAEP, from the new NAEP, from PARC, from Smulder Balance, rotate them all together. And you can actually produce with one assessment design, with each kid who sampled only taking one assessment, a fulsome representation of all of those content demands, and give people what they want, which is comparison on all of those things. And that's why I put sampling in the third bullet, big. Like if I had to do one thing to make things better, I would have people understand that accountability tests are for valid external comparisons. They need to be the best representation of content, not a cheap thing you can get off the shelf. They could be short, if you use a sampling strategy, and they have to yield the kinds of comparisons that people want. It's literally possible with NAEP, for example, at most grade levels, most content areas, one content area is covered by 20 booklets, right? Each kid takes one less than a classroom period booklet, but it takes 20 booklets, stack them up, to cover the content domain, and that's just for one assessment in one content area. But if you just use representative sampling, you can actually get that kind of data on all the content areas. And if you want to, they call it spiraling. They bring each of the assessments in, and we could do that with PISA in the same assessment instead of yet another product to buy, yet another sampling strategy, yet another thing to impose on students so that they have to do NAEP and PISA if we want both of those comparisons. And Marie, this is the shout out to you. We were talking before the meeting. Some ways that this also helps. This also helps because if the content domain is large enough, teaching to it no longer leads to the kind of corruption that I was talking about when I was talking about the ice cream cone example, right? It's such a variety of ways that we're actually answering the transfer of skills problem, the generalizability of, if I know one-third this way, do I also know one-third that way? In fact, do I know all the fractions? Do I even know more complicated fractions? Those are addressed by having so broad a representation of the content domain that teaching to it is good instruction. It isn't subversive. And this is ultimately the way you get better assessment and less burden. Here's a summary of what I think we need to think about the current interim assessment products. I would suggest that many of them will be less desirable, and you should sit down with the content experts in your district and ask them how well those old multiple choice items, a few of the interim assessments are a combination of multiple choice and open-ended, but even the open-ended items may not be very ambitious. They certainly haven't thought about teaching how practices are integrated with content. So have your content experts look at how adequate the existing interim assessments are substantively as preparation for the more ambitious tests. And by the way, don't just look at PARC. Look at PISA and look at Smarter Balance, because it's this whole array of what's referred to as next generation assessments that we want to be sure we're attending to when we're now solving local problems. Ask if there are better alternatives, and I believe that there are, both for evaluating your program and for the classroom. If you're buying the separation that I'm pitching, then I would ask, before you pay for anything that's an interim product, ask yourself if you've done everything there is to be done with the state assessment results to do program evaluation. Look for relative weaknesses curricularly. Look at gender and group differences. Look at how well you're performing compared to demographic equivalent, et cetera. If you've done all that and you're still hungry for more information, then the question is, what can the interim assessment add? But since they are not generally as good a product substantively as the state test, I would urge you to figure out what you can learn from the state test before you buy one of those products. And for student assessment, consider something very different that will be on the next formative assessment slide. And if you've done those two comparisons, you may want to consider eliminating or sharply reducing your investment in interim testing products. So here's the formative assessment pitch. It requires an understanding of that literature and of the processes. So as soon as a teacher starts warning kids about the grades they're going to get if they do or don't do X, then they're missing the point of that whole literature. It's fine if teachers still need to grade, but to use assessment to improve learning, you have to create safe spaces where kids will take risks, admit what they don't know, ask questions, and learn from the interaction. And that is a process and cultural practice difference right alongside substantive tasks that better represent ambitious content. And you have to have both the tools and the ethos, or everything that's claimed in that formative assessment literature won't work. So rich tasks and assessment prompts can help teacher learning. So if you're going to do this, you have to think about, how can I help teachers learn to do this? And how will these prompts help them focus on student thinking and help them learn how to build on student thinking, elicit and build on student thinking. And what I've argued for in other talks, again, you're getting sort of the distillation of a stack of talks. Talk on replacement units is about how that seems to be about the right size for teacher learning. So I'm not asking anybody to deliver a whole curricular change from September to May. What I'm saying is, if I have to learn how to teach something in a really different way, how about a three-week unit with some support and collaboration with colleagues to try it out with my students, to try some questioning that an expert has prepared for me so that I don't have to make it up myself, and then let's see if I can learn how to do it. And where I've run projects like this, what I've just been always awed at how then teachers will run with it and learn how to generalize it. So if we did it with multiplication, learn how to generalize it to measurement and geometry that they had to teach subsequently. So it's a strategy for giving resources in a way that supports student-teacher learning alongside student learning. So here are just a couple of examples. I know I showed these in Boulder Valley once before, but the rest of the group hasn't seen them. These are examples of when you ask experts to help you develop tasks. This is a single question that is used instructionally, or if you knew the kids had had this instruction around this, you could develop parallel items that would ask them new challenging questions. The kids had to draw models of what they thought was happening with the plus and minus charges in a magnetized nail. So they'd rubbed it and now it's magnetized, and they had drawn this picture. It's not a correct picture, right? With all the positive things at the one end and the negative things at the other end, and this is a common misconception. And as soon as you ask the kids, what would happen to your model if I cut the nail in half? And they just look at you like, oh my goodness, the model can't be right. That question doesn't tell them what the model is, but they have to think, they immediately know, boy, those red and blue guys have to run around really fast if the model's going to be cut in half. So they have to come up with a new way of organizing their thinking to draw a new model. That's from my colleague, Professor Valerie Otero, and her graduate students. This one is from another colleague, Erin Furtak. This is also a wrong answer, but it's a common misconception when you're teaching natural selection. Every kid reinvents the Lamarckian explanation for evolution, right? That the giraffes just stretched their necks, as opposed to understand how the adaptation that was required happened over a long period of time, and also happened by some people dying because their necks weren't long enough, or in this case, their beaks weren't small enough. These are the kinds of questions that further the learning and provide an insight when you share them with kids so that they can have an understanding. And when they don't, teachers then have some strategies developed around this about what to do when the kids answer this. And it's almost never just tell them the answer. It's where are you headed and what things have worked before to help the kids get there. This is Erin Furtak again, and these are just some things she developed around learning progressions, particularly in science, that help support teacher learning as well as student learning. So these kinds of instructional strategies document student ideas as they develop from alternative conception to scientifically accurate understanding. So this is a project that she led to have teachers work on keeping track of what happens every time you try to teach natural selection. Turns out the kids have a variety of ways of doing it, but once you've done it once and then again, pretty soon the unusualness of their responses slows down. And the several ways that kids come to understand it can be used as a resource because you get familiar with the ways they usually think about it. And then what helps them make progress? What thing could you say, like, or question could you ask, like cutting the nail in half? What helps them get further? And of course, you want to have these kinds of things, suggested feedback for students responding to the various levels. Lastly, so here's the idea of an enlightened assessment system. Again, emphasizing the idea that the two types of assessments would be different, but that they would be sort of cognizant of each other in a coherent relationship, the accountability test and what happens in the classroom. So as knowing what students know, authors argued, there should be this shared model of learning. Not only what the standards say the kids should know, but a little bit more from having studied efforts to teach them those things, what does it take to get them there? So that's part of this shared model of learning. The external accountability tests, finally the answer to the title of the talk, the external accountability tests can be instructionally relevant to the extent that the tasks in the accountability tests are models of the ambitious learning goals that are in the standards, right? And that you can use the data from the test to make your program better. But they aren't delivered in time, nor are they targeted right where each student is to be able to inform individual instruction. Separate, conceptually rich tasks can support individual student learning and help teachers learn to teach in very different ways. Thank you.
So how do we, as local policy members, makers, influence the system to move in this direction to do what's better for our students?
Well, I think you have complete control over how many of those in-between tests. And I'm just trying to heighten for people. Investing in those things are not the same thing as investing in the quality tasks. It's harder for you, though I would say social media is on your side, and what the students are doing is on the side of having what local people think affect the state. And I have to tell you, you know, when I come to talk with you with that old person feeling like, oh heavens, you know, we've tried to say this sensibly before. So I was one of the experts that was called in to testify regionally. There were four hearings held around the country about what should happen with all that race to the top money that was going into developing. And the governors were having none of it because we said, you can't make an operational test that is next generation good and by 2014. You can't do it. The experts are here to tell you that you should put the money into developing pilot and sample assessments that would eventually get us to something better than the TCAP. Because I do think that's why I said this is a worry, because PARC is probably better than TCAP. That's what's so sad about, you know, scuttling it. But I'm arguing at the national level about NAEP that people should be integrating and trying to solve the sampling there with PISA coming in and urging them to coordinate with PARC and Smarter Balance to integrate so that there's one sampling, not layers and layers. It could happen. This would be a really good question for me. I was thinking after the conversations I've had here today before this, it would be a good question to ask Robert Hammond. Could the users of PARC negotiate to use it for sampling instead of every pupil testing? I mean, that's something that came to me as I was listening to the complaints about burden. Because I don't think you want to abandon an external test. I don't think you even want to abandon a better than we've had external test that does a better job than past in integrating the content standards with more processes, like we want to represent ambitious learning goals. But you don't want it to be so burdensome that the whole system collapses. And you certainly have to be informed enough about these arguments. I mean, both of those consortia, Smarter Balanced and PARC, were bogged down by timing. That is, they had to produce a product, but they also misunderstood this idea of instructional relevance. They actually thought they were going to deliver in October a test thing that was going to be used for formative purposes, and it was going to be added up at the end of the year. That was more Smarter Balanced than PARC. But both of the consortia were confused about this idea of doing both things. And then, of course, because they'd promised to produce the state test, they abandoned, good thing, all of their formative ideas. We tried to tell them they could build replacement units that could be conceptually coherent with PARC. That would be a good thing, and they just ran out of money to do that. It would still be possible to have support from more than every local district to build conceptually coherent. They're not practice tests. They're not drilling for the test. They're what does the instructional unit look like that actually gets you favorably to the content in PARC, but without the shortcuts, without the, they know it only this way, and they've only memorized to get there. No, we want to develop deep conceptual understanding so that they will do well on the test. Any way we ask them, they would do well. So it's a different version of the sampling answer that I gave before.
But when you're saying sampling, you're saying every student takes a test, but each test may be slightly different so that you sample the entire.
That's right.
All of the standards.
Does that meet what the federal guidelines are?
No. Okay. That's a good question, because that could also be changed. So Marie was saying, I'm saying to be like NAEP and to reduce burden, you don't have to produce a score on every student. And I can tell you who the policymakers were in the 70s who said, I can see his face, and he is saying that he was so angry with public schools that he hated every time the Gallup poll came out and said that every parent surveyed worries about the national schools, but is proud of their neighborhood school. Remember that? And he was going to teach them a lesson by giving them bad scores for their local school, because this was going to mobilize effort to get after those bad schools. And what that policy stance did was get us every pupil testing. Every kid has to have the exact same test, because it's only fair if I'm going to tell the parents the score that it's not particular to this test that I took or that test that I took. Another horrible thing that happened, policymakers, I blame them, was there's now a politicized board that oversees the National Assessment of Educational Progress. And that NAGB, National Assessment Governing Board, believes that their framework has to be a fourth grade framework for the fourth grade test and an eighth grade framework for the eighth grade test. And what that says is that it can't even tell me anything about how a below grade level student gained. So tests that are built to that model are very unfair to schools whose kids are gaining in a different region of the test. So that's another, that's what I mean by kind of superficial understandings. Of course we want grade level frameworks. But what the psychometricians will tell you is that we can equate all that, and someone could take an easier test and it wouldn't give them a better score. It could be linked to the test and we could see where they actually were performing in relation to kids who took the harder test. So it's a matter of getting clear about what you want to do and then using the technology to do it. And my fear is that the more people have just blended all their purposes, the worse we've been, the worse it comes to be.
So staying on the sampling thing, I'm trying to understand how that would look for, say, a state accountability test at the district or individual school level. Can you just say a little more?
Yeah, so in California years and years ago when we did it, we had to recognize how we spread out the work. So using the NAEP example, or in California, I think we only had about 10 booklets instead of 20 booklets to cover reading at a grade level. And so then you would go into a classroom and they are randomly sorted, so the kids get booklets, and everyone is taking a different part of the test. And the average of those tests is just as valid as the average of the average of all the kids taking the exact same test. Now that we have another whole topic, computer-delivered assessments, we can actually do it better than that, because some of those kids got a booklet where they could only do the first four problems and then they couldn't do anything more. We can actually now do what's called out-of-level testing, if the policymakers would let us, where the kids would do one or two tasks early, or teachers would assign them ahead of time, and then they would take a level-appropriate booklet, and they could do everything that they were able to do, and it would be statistically equated with the other booklets in the class and in the whole system, so that we got actually much better data. It turns out the standard errors on that kind of assessment are smaller, because every kid is assessed accurately. And by the way, teachers who've been in this kind of environment tell you it's a better environment, because there aren't kids who just are sitting there and not able to really participate. So there are ways that we can cover the content better and even have the kids have a better experience that's less testing time than current.
And how much less in that California example? By how much time was it reduced?
You can reduce it to one test period. And while you're at it, now I'll give you the good version and the bad version, right? While you're at it, you can sample across content areas if all you cared about was a school score. In California, we had to set a limit because we said fewer than 30 students in a school, and they had to do double testing. So then the kids in the schools that were tiny had to have two testing periods, right? But you could actually sample across subject areas. So one kid is taking reading and another kid is taking social studies. So there's really no limit to this except law that says, now I need teacher scores. So we're working, this is why I come at it with such you know, worry. What can I tell you that's good news? Because in California, we only had to have reliable school scores. Now you have to have reliable teacher scores. And that further limits. The kids have to test more to give you teacher scores that are accurate. And that's in Colorado then driven things further even than whatever's in the federal regs.
Let me. Dr. Shepard, this is a nice follow-up to that question. It's based upon your conversation in the context of intrinsic versus extrinsic motivation. Is what are some pros and cons that you see in terms of possibly tying a teacher's evaluation up to 50% of a high-stakes testing score?
Well, Carrie, sitting right here, knows that I have been a reluctant helper making lemonade in an environment where I strongly disapprove of the law.
Could you say a little more?
Yeah, please.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that the exact same, you're obviously inviting a generalization from what has mostly been studied about kids learning to teachers as learners and teachers as professionals. And what do we know? Number one, about why they enter the profession, mostly for altruistic reasons, and what it does to put them in an environment of rewards and punishments. Also, we know a different body of research on learning is and motivation is what happens when the things that are out of your control. And so I do think that we are seeing an increasing negative environment for teachers and teachers' work. The survey data all shows this because of the disrespect that is coming, led to the law and follows from the law. Is then experienced on the ground. Because if it is unfair, you see people end up cheating. I'm not proud of that. You end up having people make choices that short of teaching, but that redirect effort in ways that they wouldn't do if they were professional. See people leaving at higher rates. I just think it is a bad environment to have that strong a weight on an external way of judging performance. And with the Colorado Growth Model, statisticians will tell you that it is what in the value-added methodology world is called an undercorrected model. The economists who develop these models will tell you they're both undercorrected and overcorrected models. The undercorrected model still leaves some of the SES differences among kids in the result. So you will still have the slight advantage for Cherry Creek and Boulder over other districts. Some economists say, oh, let's fix that. And if you think, well, let's do the overcorrected model, it just shows that they have more confidence in their ability to dictate to the world than I would have. The overcorrected model from the economists says, we want the best teachers in every school to be told they're doing a good job. So let's tell them that and just correct it, add in more statistical controls, and then it creates a flat scatter plot where they're in very poor performing schools, they're the same number of good and bad teachers as in very high performing schools. And then each teacher gets told what these economists think they should be told. But what the data tell us for sure is that the truth is halfway in between. It's somewhere in between. The truth is somewhere in between. And it's probably true that in the highest performing schools, some amount of that is the kids and some amount of that is the teachers. But look how... not to speak inappropriately, and I'm trying not to say the word crazy. And I can't speak. It's so out of control. It's so unfair. It's so undefensible to create that kind of a scheme and then think that people underneath it will feel that they're being treated fairly and sensibly.
So I'm going to throw a tiny bit of cold water. If we could convince the money that everything you've taught us today is correct, it would still take me 5 years to see that get into the classroom level. And you mentioned early on in the presentation that we should be doing all that we can with the state assessment, which I really appreciate. And that's the vision I would hold out for teachers. What are some of the all that we can pieces for a test where we don't get the results? We get results for a group of students that we didn't instruct in our elementary grades in particular, and that lag is the one thing that teachers constantly say to me prevents them from using state-level assessment data in any relevant way for students. And I know that's not what it was designed for, but what is the all that we can do with what we have today?
Okay, so there's a couple of different pieces that I would look at. And I do think that the Colorado Growth Model for schools is helpful because it does help you with comparisons that matter. So whereas NCLB just said, you know, we're going to have everybody proficient, let me suggest an alternative that my colleague Bob Lynn suggested, which is what he calls existence proofs. So if I am working in a low-performing school, we don't want to encourage that person to say, oh, it's just the kids I'm serving. So we want them to set appropriate goals given the kids they're serving. And we even want to recognize when they're doing an exceptionally good job serving those kids well. And so his existence proof idea was to look at similarly situated schools and then not take the average of those schools as fine, you're above the average of those schools. Well, no, why don't we set the 90th percentile of those schools, similarly situated, and ask why everyone isn't there? Some people are doing it. Why don't we ask ourselves, what should we do to be like that? And notice how much that would leverage up if everybody, for their same demographics, was trying to find out how to do as well as others at their same demographic. And look at it disaggregated in ways, but always relative, right? So that there's somebody who is serving your same group of students and doing it better than you are. That is a leveraging up, and it's not the same, in my view, as the set astronomical standards like NCLB did, right? And I do think I would want to look for sure, and I think this is a perfect August conversation, and that's why it's being late doesn't matter. No, I'm planning my program for the coming year. And so to the extent that for any given content area, I can look at whether we're doing relatively better in vocabulary than in comprehension, because there are schools where that is true. They're kind of getting stuck, and they don't have as much resource for working on comprehension, then that's what I'm going to pay attention to. So I would look at the subscores in August to have a content exam, an examination of my curriculum, and I would look in August at my subgroups so that I could see if where it is, and it is very like what the teachers are doing with that grid, and they make one or two decisions, right? I can help these two kids, and I can work on this standard. I've only got time to work on this one standard, and then I'm moving on, right? And then what we know from the slide I had up from Dick Elmore's work is, we have to have some resource for the ones who've saying, well, what could I do to do better? Because in the schools where there's the most struggle, they don't necessarily know the answer to that. The state test will help say, here's where effort would make the most difference. But in under-resourced environments, I think you could help find the resource that would be a substantive answer to how to do better. I'm not sure. I mean, the interim assessments are commercial products that are sold nationally, and so they're more generic even than the state test. So you have to know where they're coming from. They're very like Texas textbooks in that they have to attend to the larger market. So I would put my money on TCAP being better content-wise than most of those products. But they're also more accessible. That's why they've sold so well, right? They can be used in individual districts with the timing that the district wants. And many districts say that they want early warning. They are early warning systems, is Dylan Williams' words for them. They've gotten a little bit better over time. The worst ones, right after NCLB came out, they were intended to predict how you performed at the end of the year, so they just were an imitation of the state tests. And that meant they were testing kids in October on stuff they weren't going to learn until March. Now, at least, they're a little better sequenced so that you could choose what about what's going to be on the state test is available in October, mid-year, and then again. I'm having trouble seeing how they could be combined. Smarter Balance tried to do it with quarterly tests that they could aggregate up, and they ran into the problem that people are teaching different things between September and October. And we do not have uniform curricula, so you cannot, within a grade, know who's going to be testing what when, teaching what when. Right, if you have an idea about how to do it, just say, and I'll tell you, you know, oh yeah, great idea, or that doesn't make sense. If you're thinking about it, I'd love to hear it.
Dr. Shepard, I don't want to take us in a direction, and if it's not appropriate, let me know, but in our state, we definitely have adopted the rank and praise and rank and shame, all compiled. We roll it forward. We line districts up from top to the bottom, praise some, beat others. What's going to happen with this new iteration? It seems like the greatest penalties and roll down on children of color and children that come from poverty and this new iteration of tests that we have coming forward, what can we expect in these districts of significant need?
Well, I'll point to my colleagues in the back and we can say a little bit more about the NEPC, National Education Policy Center at CU Boulder, has a new initiative on opportunity schools, because what we'd like to do is find, identify, and congratulate the schools that are making a difference for the population they serve. So that's one project that is meant to get the tone right, because for most reporting systems that state assessments face is that they face this idea. We certainly faced it in the 1970s in California when, you know, they first wanted to start ranking schools and Beverly Hills was on top, right? So the first thing you want to do is adjust for demographics. But adjusting for demographics is an insult to many groups because it sets low standards. So that's why I don't like either one of the models that the economists come up with when they're trying to adjust, right? You have to keep awareness of the adjustment. You have to keep it right in your face instead of two different ways of ranking where the public doesn't understand what's going on secretly underneath the numbers. It's much better to have the user have to keep track of the fact that they're invoking for similarly situated, for kids that come with this need to school, how well is the school serving them and moving them forward, et cetera. So I would be for juxtaposing those things so that you can see and congratulate at every level of population served across the state who's at the 90th percentile of similarly situated schools. Because I think that's the way to say, can't make an excuse if you're below the median of that group. If you're below, why not at the 90th percentile? Let's ratchet it up that way. And I'm looking for that way of doing both.
Who's got a question?
So, Lorrie, what do we, so I'm going to get out of testing and instruction and get to politics. So what do we do to change the political climate in this state so that our elected officials will listen to experts such as yourself and others, because these are just bad laws, and they're based on ill-founded philosophies and strategies that will ultimately damage students and our profession. And we've got folks like you and others that really could help inform policymakers and lawmakers to create a better learning environment. So to Michael's point, we would actually be investing our resources on helping all children be successful versus punishing educators and communities for taking tests and failing in a system that's just basically designed poorly. And if they're doing this to other areas of our state as they are to education, you know, maybe we could drink fracking water. I don't know. I mean, who would know? So you've been doing this for a while and have been asked not to attend meetings as an expert. So talk to us about the political climate and what we can do as advocates for children and for our profession to keep us from crashing.
Well, I think that's why I started with the old lady picture. You're just asking me to step way outside of what I'm an expert at. I have been defeated by that. I don't know how to do that. And most importantly, I don't have enough time, because what I notice is that the people who are affecting those decisions and those ways of thinking, they're in Denver all day, every day. I once thought maybe I could spend my summers trying to get to staffers, because one thing I noticed from my few forays into Denver and talking to policymakers is that the staffers come back every summer, after every summer, with some new idea. You know, so they kind of go around to workshops and institutes or whatever they do that the Aspen Institute or Pew or whomever is gathering them all together, and there is groupthink. And they get these ideas, and I'm talking over a 30-year period now, that things that I've pointing to, I could tell you in any given year when a particular one of these, oh, we got to have this, and oh, VAM that, and oh, teacher effectiveness. And the people who have access to those summer workshops and institutes are driving it. This amount of talking is, we know that, we're all educators in the room. We know that that's not enough talking to change anybody's mind. It's who they then have lunch with and who they're talking to. And over time, it's a full-time job to try to affect this kind of change. And I have enormous regard, God bless you, Carrie, for like saying, okay, I'm going to leave the classroom, and I'm going to spend all day, every day on this topic. And there are other people around who, for representatives of the organization, Jane is back there, all day, every day, trying to affect how people think about these issues. And, you know, this could be an outline for, like, what things you want to argue. But I am not an expert on how to reach and how to have a shared understanding, right? Because it takes some will to have some shared understanding. People know they want comparisons, but you notice that people are running for different things. So at the very time when you're worried about too much testing, I can tell you there are countless superintendents who are going after PISA, who are agreeing, yes, we'll bring PISA in to do comparisons. It was superintendents who got TUDA, who got what does TUDA stand for? The large district version of NAEP, right? They brought NAEP in and are doing more testing in addition to their state testing because they wanted NAEP. And they didn't ask their state to integrate NAEP because of the every pupil testing laws. They just added it. So you guys know more about politics than I do.
We've got our time for one more question. yelling or you can wait for me.
This is not a question, it's a thank you. You have done so much for our profession to help us grow. When 191 came in, I went to the research bank and I saw what you wrote and your colleagues wrote. Took it downtown to talk to our legislators who were developing that, and they said, gee, I've never seen that research. And so it's important for us as professionals to at least learn the sound bites here and politically have the right people talking to our own individual legislators. Now, I'm talking politics. We could talk all day, but my main message, Lorrie, is thank you so much for what you do. You are an excellent teacher. We've grown because of you, and we have a dialogue going that we never had before, so thank you. Thanks.